Bioenergetics is the quantitative study of the energy transductions that occur in living cells and of the nature and function of the chemical processes underlying these transductions. Or simply stated, bioenergetics is the study of the energy changes that accompany chemical reactions. Metabolism, which is the sum total of all the biochemical processes within the body, consists of different energy utilizing and energy liberating reactions. In metabolism, metabolic fuel is utilized through biological oxidations, and the energy produced from such reactions may be utilized to drive the energy requiring reactions. The relationship between these two types of reaction is studied in bioenergetics, also called biochemical thermodynamics. It is thus important to review the principles of thermodynamics to appreciate how energy producing and energy utilizing metabolic reactions can take place within the same cell and how an organism is able to accomplish various work functions. Cells and organisms must perform work to stay alive, to grow, and to reproduce. The ability to harness energy and to channel it into biological work is a fundamental property of all living organisms. It must have been acquired very early in cellular evolution. Modern organisms carry out a remarkable variety of energy transductions, conversions of one form of energy to another. They use the chemical energy in fuels to bring about the synthesis of complex, highly ordered macromolecules from simple precursors. They also convert the chemical energy of fuels into concentration gradients and electrical gradients into motion and heat. This exchange of energy is mediated by the universal energy currency, the adenosine triphosphate or ATP. Thus, bioenergetics is involved in the usage of energy in anabolic and catabolic processes. From this illustration, we can simply say that without energy, all metabolic processes stopped and life ends. We are all composed of cells. In the bioenergetics world, it is the cells that are the consummate transducers of energy, capable of interconverting chemical, electromagnetic, mechanical, and osmotic energy with great efficiency. Thus, a lot of energy interconversion occur in living organisms. Let's go through this step by step. First, organisms will have to take in potential energy from the environment. These are the nutrients taken from the surroundings in the form of food, or for photosynthetic plants, sunlight. Subsequently, these organisms convert some of this energy derived from the environment into useful forms of energy for work like biochemical synthesis, locomotion and other mechanical work, osmotic and electrical gradients, and genetic information transfer. However, not all energy will be converted to work. Some will be returned to the surroundings in the form of heat. Concomitantly, during the process, these organisms will release back to the environment end product molecules like water, carbon dioxide, urea, substances all that are less well organized than the starting fuel, thereby increasing the disorderliness of the universe. And lastly, one effect of all these transformations is increased order or direct decreased randomness within the organism in the form of complex macromolecules and an organized system of structure and function. This is putting bioenergetics in its proper context, how we, living, growing, and breathing organisms, transduce energy in order to live. We can't really understand bioenergetics without delving in the natural laws that govern biological reactions and systems as well. Let us now jump into some serious stuff. The laws of thermodynamics give us the guidelines for the interconversion of energy from one form to the other. Let us first define what thermodynamics is. Thermodynamics is a branch of physics that deals with heat, work, and temperature, and the relation to energy, radiation, and physical properties of matter. The behavior of these quantities is governed by the four laws of thermodynamics, which convey a quantitative description using measurable macroscopic physical quantities but may be explained in terms of microscopic constituents by statistical mechanics. Additionally, thermodynamics applies to a wide variety of topics in science and engineering, especially physical chemistry, chemical engineering, and mechanical engineering, but also in other complex fields such as meteorology. I think no one, including me, understood what I just said. Anyway, let us try to simplify this concept and just jump straight into its biochemical applications. We will just discuss the first two laws of thermodynamics. There are four laws, but it is only the first two laws that mostly pertain to biological systems. The first of these laws is the principle of the conservation of energy. This law states that for any physical or chemical change, the total amount of energy in the universe remains constant. In the same vein, energy may change form or it may be transported from one region to another, but it cannot be created nor destroyed. In connection with the first law, the law of energy conservation, one thermodynamic quantity becomes relevant. In the realm of physics, enthalpy, symbolized by the capital letter H, of a thermodynamic system is defined as the sum of its internal energy and the work required to achieve its pressure and volume. Biochemically, however, enthalpy or H can be simply referred to as the heat content of the reacting system. It reflects the number and kinds of chemical bonds in the reactants and products. The total enthalpy of a system cannot be measured directly because the internal energy contains components that are unknown, not easily accessible, or are not of interest in thermodynamics. In practice, a change in the enthalpy, or delta H, is the preferred expression for measurements at constant pressure because it simplifies the description of energy transfer. When matter transfer into or out of the system is also prevented, the enthalpy change equals the energy exchanged with the environment by heat. Change in enthalpy, as we mentioned previously, is measured as the difference in the energy content or enthalpy of the products in relation to the reactants. So the change in enthalpy or delta H of a reaction is computed as the enthalpy of the products minus the enthalpy of the reactants. Thus, when a chemical reaction releases heat, as is shown here, it is said to be exothermic. The heat content of the products is less than that of the reactants, and thus delta H has a negative value. On the other hand, when reacting systems take up heat from their surroundings, these reactions are considered endothermic and have positive values of delta H or change in enthalpy. This means the heat content of the products is more than the heat content of the reactants. The second law of thermodynamics states that the universe always tends toward increasing disorder. To paraphrase, in all natural processes, the entropy of the universe increases. Living organisms consist of collections of molecules much more highly organized than the surrounding materials from which they are constructed from. And organisms maintain and produce order seemingly oblivious to the second law of thermodynamics. But living organisms do not violate the second law. They operate strictly within it. To discuss the application of the second law to biological systems, we must first define those systems and their surroundings. To continue, the reacting system is a collection of matter that is undergoing a particular chemical or physical process. It may be an organism, a cell, or two reacting compounds. In the example we will use later to explain change in entropy, the system will be the tea kettle and the universe is the kitchen. The reacting system and its surroundings together constitute the universe. Living cells and organisms are open systems, exchanging both material and energy with their surroundings. Additionally, living systems are never at equilibrium with their surroundings, and the constant transactions between a system and surroundings explain how organisms can create order within themselves while operating within the second law of thermodynamics. Let us now define what entropy means. Entropy, indicated as the capital letter S, is a quantitative expression for the randomness or disorderliness of a system. When the products of a reaction are less complex and more disordered than the reactants, the reaction is said to proceed with a gain in entropy. It is positive when randomness increases and is negative when randomness or disorderliness is decreased. Entropy came from the Greek word tropos, meaning transformation or a change within. To further understand entropy in the context of biological systems, let us look into the analogy of the tea kettle and the randomization of heat. We know that steam generated from boiling water can do useful work. But suppose we turn off the burner under a tea kettle full of water at 100 degrees centigrade, which represents the system in the kitchen or the surroundings, and allow the tea kettle to cool down. As it cools down, no work is done, but heat passes from the tea kettle to the surroundings, raising the temperature of the surroundings, the kitchen in this case, by an infinitesimally small amount until complete equilibrium is attained. At this point, all parts of the tea kettle and the kitchen are at precisely the same temperature. The free energy that was once concentrated in the tea kettle of hot water at 100 degrees centigrade, potentially capable of doing work, has disappeared. Its equivalent in heat energy is still present in the tea kettle plus kitchen or the universe, but has become completely randomized throughout. The energy is no longer available to do work because there is no temperature differential within the kitchen. Moreover, the increase in entropy of the kitchen or the surroundings is irreversible. We know from everyday experience that heat never spontaneously passes back from the kitchen into the tea kettle to raise the temperature of the water to 100 degrees centigrade again. What happened here is an increase in entropy or the state of disorderliness in the universe. Moving on, all processes tend to progress toward the situation of maximum entropy, as we have seen in the tea kettle analogy. Thus, it is easy to see now that creating and maintaining order within a system like the cell requires work and energy. DNA, RNA, and proteins are informational macromolecules. In addition to using chemical energy to form the covalent bonds between the subunits in these polymers, the cell must invest energy to order the subunits in their correct sequence. It is extremely improbable that amino acids in a mixture would spontaneously condense into a single type of protein with a unique sequence. This would represent increased order in a population of molecules. But according to the second law of thermodynamics, the tendency in nature is toward ever greater disorder in the universe. The total entropy of the universe is continually increasing. Thus, to bring about the synthesis of macromolecules from their monomeric units, free energy must be supplied to the system, in this case, the cell. To reiterate, the second law of thermodynamics states that the entropy of the universe increases during all chemical and physical processes, but it does not require that the entropy increase takes place in the reacting system itself. The order produced within cells as they grow and divide is more than compensated for by the disorder they create in their surroundings during growth and division. In short, living organisms preserve their internal order by taking from the surroundings free energy in the form of nutrients or sunlight and returning to their surroundings an equal amount of energy as heat and entropy. To continue, the total entropy of a system must increase if a process is to occur spontaneously. Entropy represents the energy of a system that is unavailable for work. Remember, entropy is a measure of disorder or randomness in a system. It is work expended to bring a system to an ordered manner. All processes must tend to progress toward the situation of maximum entropy. Living systems that are highly ordered are never at equilibrium with their surroundings, as equilibrium in a system will result when randomness or disorder is at a maximum. We will now relate the second law of thermodynamics to the first law, as we will see in the next few slides. Having revisited and studied the two laws of thermodynamics governing biochemistry and metabolism, we are now ready to apply such to the energy changes during chemical reactions. J. Willard Gibbs, an American chemist who we will meet later, developed the theory of energy changes during chemical reactions. He postulated and successfully elucidated that the free energy content, C symbolized as the capital letter G of any closed systems can be defined in terms of three thermodynamic quantities. The first is enthalpy or H, reflecting the number and kinds of bonds within the reacting system. Entropy or S, representing the disorderliness of the systems before and after the reaction, and the absolute temperature in degrees Kelvin. He came to the conclusion that the defined free energy into this equation is change in free energy is equal to the change in enthalpy minus temperature times the change in entropy. When a chemical reaction occurs at constant temperature, the free energy change or delta G is determined by the enthalpy change or delta H, reflecting the kinds and numbers of chemical bonds and non-covalent interactions broken and formed, and the entropy change or delta S, describing the change in the system's randomness. All chemical reactions are influenced by two forces: the tendency to achieve the most stable bonding state, for which enthalpy H is a useful expression, and the tendency to achieve the highest degree of randomness, expressed as entropy or S. The net driving force in a reaction is delta G, the free energy change, which represents the net effect of these two factors. Taking this further and analyzing the equation, we can see that delta S, or change in entropy, has a positive sign when entropy increases, and delta H, or change in enthalpy, has a negative sign when heat is released by the system to its surroundings. Either of these conditions, which are typical of favorable processes, tend to make the change in free energy, or delta G, negative. In fact, the delta G of a spontaneously reacting system is always negative. The units of delta G and delta H are joules per mole, or calories per mole, while the units of entropy are joules per mole Kelvin. Heat as a form of energy is not useful to the cell. Chemical energy in the form of ATP would be most useful. Going back to Josiah Willard Gibbs, he was an American chemist who related chemical, electrical, and thermal energy and their capacity to perform work. These potential energies would be called Gibbs free energy. He also independently invented the mathematics of vector analysis. The thermodynamic quantity Gibbs free energy, or G, named after him, expresses the amount of energy capable of doing work during a reaction at constant temperature and pressure. It expresses the amount of available energy that can be extracted and harnessed from a closed system that can be used to do useful work. In computing for the change in free energy, or delta G, one has always to take the difference between the free energy of the products and that of the free energy of the reactants. Or to put it in another way, delta G is the difference between the free energy levels of the final and initial intermediates. In short, it should be final minus initial, or products minus reactants. Thereby, delta G expresses the amount of energy capable of doing work during a reaction at constant temperature and pressure. More importantly, it allows one to predict the feasibility of a reaction, the direction of chemical reaction, either towards the products or will favor the reactants, and the exact equilibrium position once the concentration of the reactants and products are the same. In studying the concept of change in free energy, or delta G, we can see that this important thermodynamic quantity will reveal to us these very important points. First, that delta G represents the free energy change at any point during transformation. Secondly, the value of delta G could determine the extent of the reaction and whether the work is performed in a reaction. Thirdly, free energy change, or delta G, represents the maximum amount of chemical energy that is potentially available for doing useful work. It is a valid method for predicting the feasibility of a reaction. And lastly, any transformation may be described by comparing the physical and chemical properties of the initial and final states of a system or a reaction. This energy diagram shown here represents three possible energy scenarios of reactions that will give different values in free energy change, or delta G. let's look at these energy scenarios more closely. This scenario is where the free energy level of the products is lower than that of the reactants. Thus, if we're going to apply this equation, the result will be delta G, or change in free energy, is less than zero, or a value that is negative, meaning that the reaction is exergonic and can spontaneously occur. This is a favorable reaction. An exergonic reaction could occur by itself and is usually associated with the loss of energy. An exothermic reaction releases energy as heat, as in this case. On the other hand, this is an energy diagram of a reaction where the free energy level of the products is higher than that of the reactants. Thus, if we're going to apply this equation, the result will be the change in free energy, or delta G value, is more than zero or has a positive value. This means that the reaction is non-spontaneous and requires addition of energy to go to completion. Therefore, this is an endergonic reaction where the products will be associated with an increase in free energy. This reaction, likewise, takes up heat energy and is called an endothermic reaction. To continue, when the free energy level of both the products and the reactants are equal, the change in free energy, or delta G, will be zero, or the reaction system has achieved equilibrium. When a system is at equilibrium, the rate of product formation exactly equals the rate at which product is converted back to the reactants. Thus, there is no net change in the concentration of reactants and products, and a steady state is achieved. The energy change as the system moves from its initial state to equilibrium with no changes in temperature or pressure is given by the free energy change, or delta G. Let us now proceed to the concept of the standard free energy change represented by the notation delta G naught prime. The standard free energy change is an alternative mathematical way of expressing a chemical reaction's equilibrium constant. It is the difference between the free energy content of the products and the free energy content of the reactants under standard conditions, specifically at 1 molar concentration of reactants at standard pressure and temperature and at a pH of 7. This quantity also governs that all chemical reactions tend to go in the direction that results in a decrease in the free energy of the system. And lastly, standard free energy change shows where the final equilibrium for a reaction lies, but tells us nothing about how fast equilibrium will be achieved. The rates of reactions are governed by the parameters of kinetics, a different topic altogether. The central issue in bioenergetics, the study of energy transformations in living systems, is the means by which energy from fuel metabolism or light capture is coupled to a cell's energy-requiring reactions. This brings us to the important biochemical concept of energy coupling. That of thermodynamically unfavored reaction can be driven by being coupled to thermodynamically favored reaction. It is a state where the output of chemical energy from exergonic reaction serves as the input of chemical energy that will drive endergonic reaction. Thinking about energy coupling, it is useful to consider a simple mechanical analogy. An object at the top of an inclined plane has a certain amount of potential energy as a result of its elevation. It tends to slide down the plane, losing its potential energy of position as it approaches the ground. When an appropriate string and pulley device couples the falling object to another, smaller object, the spontaneous downward motion of the larger can lift the smaller, accomplishing a certain amount of work. The amount of energy available to do work is the free energy change, or delta G. This is always somewhat less than the theoretical amount of energy released because some energy is dissipated as the heat of friction. The greater the elevation of the larger object, the greater the energy released, or delta G, as the object slides downwards, and the greater the amount of work that can be accomplished. Let us now apply this concept biochemically. Let us consider the following reactions. In reaction 1, the formation of glucose 6-phosphate from glucose and inorganic phosphate yields a product of higher energy than the two reactants. For this endergonic reaction, delta G1 is positive. In reaction 2, the exergonic breakdown of adenosine triphosphate can drive an endergonic reaction when the two reactions are coupled. As we can see, the exergonic reaction has a large negative free energy change, or delta G2, and the endergonic reaction has a smaller positive free energy change, or delta G1. The third reaction accomplishes the sums of reactions 1 and 2, and the free energy change, or delta G3, is the arithmetic sum of delta G1 and delta G2. Because delta G3 is negative, the overall reaction is exergonic and will thus proceed spontaneously. Standard free energy changes of coupled reactions are additive. Free energy changes for chemical reactions can be added and subtracted to give free energy changes for other chemical reactions. Reactions in which chemical bonds are formed between two organic molecules are usually catalyzed by enzymes that transfer energy from cleavage of ATP in a phosphoryl transfer reaction, or by enzymes that cleave a high energy bond in an activated intermediate of the pathway. This principle of bioenergetics explains how a thermodynamically unfavorable or endergonic reaction can be driven in the forward direction by coupling it to a highly exergonic reaction through a common intermediate. This is a specific example to illustrate this principle in tangible terms. Let's look at the basic reaction that you will meet early in your study of metabolic processes: the synthesis of glucose-6-phosphate, the first step in the utilization of glucose by many organisms. The reaction, glucose plus inorganic phosphate, giving rise to glucose-6-phosphate, has a standard free energy change of positive 3.3 kilocalorie per mole. The positive value of the free energy change predicts that under standard conditions, the reaction will tend not to proceed spontaneously in the direction written. On the other hand, another cellular reaction, the hydrolysis of ATP to ADP and inorganic phosphate, is very exergonic, with a large standard free energy change of about negative 7.3 kilocalorie per mole. These two reactions share the common intermediates, inorganic phosphate and water, and may be expressed as sequential reactions as follows: glucose plus ATP resulting to glucose-6-phosphate plus ADP with a standard free energy change of negative 4.0 kilocalorie per mole. So the overall standard free energy change is obtained by adding the G values for the individual reactions, again resulting to negative 4.0 kilocalorie per mole standard free energy change for the reaction. The overall reaction is exergonic. In this case, the energy stored in ATP is used to drive the synthesis of glucose-6-phosphate, even though its formation from glucose and inorganic phosphate is endergonic. The pathway of glucose-6-phosphate formation by phosphoryl transfer from ATP is different from reactions 1 and 2 above, but the net result is the same as the sum of the two reactions. In thermodynamic calculations, all that matters is the state of the system at the beginning of the process and its state at the end. The route between the initial and final states is immaterial. Another representation of the additive property of coupled reactions: the overall change in free energy of the overall or net reaction is just the arithmetic sum of the change in free energies of the two coupled reactions. Again, to reiterate, the free energy change for a reaction is independent of the pathway by which the reaction occurs. Free energy changes are additive. The net chemical reaction that results from successive reactions sharing a common intermediate has an overall free energy change that is just the sum of the delta G values for the individual reactions. This common intermediate strategy is employed by all living cells in the synthesis of metabolic intermediates and cellular components. The common intermediate mentioned, mostly used in coupled reactions, are usually compounds of high energy potential that will couple both the exergonic and endergonic reactions together. This common intermediate is usually a high-energy compound that will not only bridge the two reactions together, but will be involved in the transfer of energy to direct both reactions to completion. Let us now move on to compounds of high energy. Many biochemical pathways form activated intermediates containing high energy bonds to facilitate biochemical work. The term high energy bond is a biologic term defined by the standard free energy for ATP hydrolysis. Any bond that can be hydrolyzed with the release of approximately as much or more energy than ATP is called a high energy bond. The high energy bond in activated intermediates, for example, such as UDP glucose in glycogen synthesis, facilitate energy transfer. High energy compounds are those that contain one or more high energy bonds and liberate about -7 to -15 kilocalories per mole of free energy when hydrolyzed. High energy compounds participate in the flow of cellular energy. Among the high energy compounds mentioned, ATP occupies central importance. This table lists down the high energy bond compounds you will commonly meet in the next lectures. These are, in the order of decreasing standard free energy change, is as follows: phosphoenol pyruvate, carbamyl phosphate, 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate, creatine phosphate, and of course the benchmark, adenosine triphosphate or ATP. Let's now examine adenosine triphosphate or ATP and discover why it is considered a high energy compound. The figure shown on the left summarizes the chemical basis for the relatively large negative standard free energy of the hydrolysis of ATP. The hydrolytic cleavage of the terminal phosphoric acid anhydride or phosphoanhydride bond in ATP separates one of the three negatively charged phosphates and thus relieves some of the electrostatic repulsion in ATP. The inorganic phosphate release is stabilized by the formation of several resonance forms not possible in ATP. In ADP-2, the other product of hydrolysis immediately ionizes, releasing hydrogen into the medium of very low hydrogen ion concentration of about 10 to the negative 7 molar. Because the concentrations of the direct products of ATP hydrolysis are, in the cell, far below the concentrations at equilibrium, the mass action favors the hydrolysis reaction in the cell. Although the hydrolysis of ATP is highly exergonic, with a standard free energy change of -7.3 kilocalories per mole or -30.5 kilojoules per mole, the molecule is kinetically stable at pH 7 because the activation energy for ATP hydrolysis is relatively high. Rapid cleavage of the phosphoanhydride bonds occurs only when catalyzed by an enzyme. Adenosine triphosphate plays a central role in metabolism. ATP is the shared chemical intermediate linking energy releasing to energy requiring cell processes. Its role in the cell is analogous to that of money in an economy. It is earned or produced in exergonic reactions and spent or consumed in endergonic ones. The overall network of enzyme-catalyzed pathways constitutes cellular metabolism. ATP is the major connecting link, or the shared intermediate between the catabolic and anabolic components of this network. The pathways of enzyme-catalyzed reactions that act on the main constituents of cells, proteins, fats, sugars, and nucleic acids, are virtually identical in all living organisms. Probably, the highest energy-containing compound is phosphoenol pyruvate or PEP. PEP contains a phosphate ester bond that undergoes hydrolysis to yield the enol form of pyruvate, and this direct product can immediately tautomerize to the more stable keto form of pyruvate. Because the reactant, phosphoenol pyruvate, has only one form, the enol form, and the product, which is pyruvate, has two possible forms, the product is stabilized relative to the reactant. This is the greatest contributing factor to the high standard free energy of hydrolysis of phosphoenol pyruvate, having a standard free energy change of almost twice that of ATP, that is, negative 14.8 kilocalorie per mole or negative 61.9 kilojoules per mole. Another high energy 3-carbon compound is 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, which contains an anhydride bond between the carboxyl group at C1 and phosphoric acid. Hydrolysis of this acyl phosphate is accompanied by a large negative standard free energy change of negative 12.3 kilocalorie per mole or negative 49.3 kilojoules per mole, which can again be explained in terms of the structure of reactants and products. When water is added across the anhydride bond of 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, one of the direct products, 3-phosphoglyceric acid, can immediately lose a proton to give the carboxylate ion 3-phosphoglycerate, which has two equally probable resonance forms. Removal of the direct product 3-phosphoglyceric acid and formation of the resonance stabilized ion favor the forward reaction. In phosphocreatine, the phosphorus nitrogen bond can be hydrolyzed to generate free creatine and inorganic phosphate. The release of inorganic phosphate and the resonance stabilization of creatine favor the forward reaction. The standard free energy change of phosphocreatine hydrolysis is again large, at negative 10.3 kilocalorie per mole or negative 43.0 kilojoules per mole. In all these phosphate releasing reactions, the several resonance forms available to inorganic phosphate stabilize this product relative to the reactant, contributing to an already negative free energy change. Low energy compounds, on the other hand, are those that yield less than negative 7.3 kilocalories per mole or less than negative 30.5 kilojoules per mole when bonds are hydrolyzed. Examples are other phosphorylated intermediates like adenosine diphosphate, pyrophosphate, glucose 1-phosphate, fructose-6-phosphate, adenosine monophosphate, glucose-6-phosphate, and glycerol-3-phosphate. As is evident from the additivity of free energy changes of sequential reactions, any phosphorylated compound can be synthesized by coupling the synthesis to the breakdown of another phosphorylated compound with a more negative free energy of hydrolysis. For example, because cleavage of inorganic phosphate from phosphoenol pyruvate or PEP releases more energy than is needed to drive the condensation of inorganic phosphate with ADP, the direct donation of a phosphoryl group from PEP to ADP to form ATP is thermodynamically feasible, as is shown here. Much of catabolism is directed toward the synthesis of high-energy phosphate compounds, but their formation is not an end in itself. They are the means of activating a very wide variety of compounds for further chemical transformation. The transfer of a phosphoryl group to a compound effectively puts free energy into that compound, so that it has more free energy to give up during subsequent metabolic transformations.
Thank you for watching this episode in this playlist. Check out the other videos in this playlist and please do subscribe to our channel and click the bell to be notified of new video episodes that will be regularly uploaded.